Mother, Mother by Annie Macmanus. Read by Bronagh, Waugh. I'm not personally obsessed with death. At a certain age, the light that you live in is inhabited by the shades. I'm very conscious that people dear to me are alive in my imagination. These people are with me. It's just a stage of your life when the death of people doesn't banish them out of your consciousness. They're part of the light in your head. Seamus Heaney. Prologue. Mary, present. She pulls up to the entrance and stops outside the gates. Leaning back as far as she can into her seat, she grips the wheel tightly, arms ruler straight. Inside the small car, there is only her and him and the sound of her short breaths. In the glare of her headlights, the ornate curls of wrought iron on the gates seem grotesque. She has never been to the cemetery so far into the night. Her head fills with memories. The slice of a shovel into soil, the growl of a mower starting up, the thick, stale air of the drying room. She inhales deeply and slips out of the car, leaving the engine running to unlock the gates with a large bunch of keys from her hoodie pocket. She rushes to the car, drives it inside, then stops again to close and lock the gates behind her before hurrying back to the car once more. She drives slowly away from the formal flower beds at the main entrance and down the slight hill of the West Road. The ground lights along the edges of the road are pathetic against the darkness, so she flicks her headlights onto full beam, and there are the rows and rows of stones falling away into the black. She always felt calmed by the uniformity of this place, the spread of fields that holds the bones and ashes of tens of thousands of lives, all neatly arranged in their allotted spaces. She knows that every life ends with words. Every life, and the dreams that come with it. She thinks of the patterns of words now as she leans forward into the wheel, how they are imprinted on her memory like street signs from childhood, how their repeated refrains echo all over this place, again and again, dearly beloved, sadly missed, in loving memory of. She feels a tightness in her throat as the headlights fall on a copse of silver birches ahead. Their white bark gleams. They're ghosts lying in wait. She quickly turns the knob to switch the lights off and stares through the glass until the birch trunks appear as dark shapes in front of her again. She will carry on without light. She knows every corner and every turn, every stone and every word etched onto it. Gone from our home but not from our hearts. Good night and God bless. In our hearts you will always stay, loved and remembered every day. She danced into our hearts. To know her was to love her. Together, always. The Lord is my shepherd, gone but not forgotten. Rest in peace, peace, perfect peace. She knows the pebbles embedded with sparkles, the paper flags, the faded flowers in glass cases, the teddy bears and the fairy doors, the stone hearts and the angels, dead-eyed and staring right through you. You have to be careful on a windy day. The trinkets can blow away from the plots. She sniffs and jolts her foot down on the accelerator so the car moves again. There is the glass surface of the lake on the right, reflecting the clouds as they jostle for front place. She pictures the moorhens, curled up in their nests at the edges of the water, their heads twisted and tucked deep into their wings, their tiny feathered chests moving with their breaths. Is the heron that lived by the lake watching over them tonight? She always loved the heron for her grace and her silence and her magisterial proportions as she took flight. She slows the car to a stop where the road bends around to the right and allows the quiet to settle around her. A small handcrafted bumblebee air freshener sways slowly on its string from the rear view mirror. She registers that her hands have stopped sweating now as she lifts him up from the passenger seat and draws him close to her chest. Her thoughts are fizzing and popping, and she has to keep moving. She has to keep moving. She sniffs loudly to break the silence and, still clutching him, climbs out of the car. They're at the very edge of the cemetery, where the paths are less worn. There are no designer pebbles here. The ground is uneven and the rectangular grave plots tilt with it, like boats on gentle waves. She walks slowly and methodically, feeling out the ground with her feet, until they stop at a small marble stone. She stands over it, resting her chin on her chest, listening to the rustles and whispers of the branches of the ash tree a few metres away. She knows that the tree will be heavy with bunches of September seed. Helicopters, they used to call them, for the way they spun through the air as they fell. She closes her eyes and hugs him close to her chest. She can feel her heart thumping frantically against him. After a few minutes, she steps up to the stone and sits down cross-legged directly in front of it, her knees wedged up against it. Carefully, she lays him on the grass beside her and turns back to the stone. It is a crude grey square, with two roses etched onto the top right and left corners, flanking the calligraphy below. She traces the letters, allowing her fingers to move shakily through the grooves, and when she gets to the end of the final number, she wraps her arms around the top of the stone and pulls herself close. It is comforting in its cold, solid form. The air fills with misty rain and its light touch feels like a caress on her skin. The damp from the grass is seeping through her leggings to her legs and bottom. She allows her back to slump over into a hunch as she leans the full weight of her head against the stone. She starts to feel her breathing slow down into a regular rhythm. She is mirrored to this marble. Wet skin on wet stone. Soaking it all in. Chapter 1. TJ, present. He lies still for a few seconds, blinking himself awake. There is a crack in the ceiling plaster and his eyes follow it to the window where the shadow of Black Mountain darkens the blind. His toes are hanging out of his Manchester United duvet and he pulls them in, rubbing his feet together to warm them. As he turns on his side to face the wardrobe, he squeezes his eyes shut and opens them wide again as if to reset himself. He isn't used to waking up so abruptly at the weekend. Normally it is a long, slow sludge into the day, a repetitive pattern of dozing and yawning that ends with the inevitable phone scroll and hauling himself out of bed on account of her shouting at him from the bottom of the stairs. He strains his ears to listen for her. Normally, her noise is filling up the house in some way. He pulls himself up to sitting, rubs his eyes and tilts back his head to shout, "Ma!" There is no reply. There's a scratchiness in the air, as if it's charged with something. He glances down at his phone on the bedside table. It tells him that it is Saturday, 15th of September, and it is 11:30 a.m. He has a night off work tonight. This is all normal. It is not normal for her to be out on a Saturday morning. He briefly contemplates the lump of hash wrapped in tinfoil in a matchbox in his bedside drawer. Not on a weekend, he thinks. Not when she's going to be around. He climbs out of bed and pulls on a pair of green tracksuit bottoms lying in a heap on the floor. His movements are reflected in the mirror stuck to the wardrobe door, and he stands still for a moment to inspect himself. His chest is concave and hairless. He inhales and pulls his shoulders back, trying to breathe some broadness into himself. His ma says he's growing in fast forward. He hopes that soon he can start growing out as well as up. He pulls open his bedroom door and shouts again, "Ma!" He walks across the tiny landing space into her room and up to her bedroom window and peers out from behind the neck curtain. Slate roofs and satellite dishes stretch into the distance. No sign of her car. He pulls his phone out of his tracksuit bottoms pocket and unlocks it with his finger. She is at the top of his list of favourites. Ma. He presses the phone button and then the speaker button and stands with the phone held by his mouth, looking out the window. He rubs his eyes, which still feels puffy from sleep, and scratches at the light fluff above his top lip. The street is busy enough for Saturday, he thinks. A new family has moved in up the road, and the dad is out washing his car with a hose and a bucket. Every so often he flicks the hose towards the twin girls who are hovering nearby, and they screech with glee and run away. He can see the clothes dangling off the washing line in the Kavanagh's back garden. Big granny knickers and the lot. Right below him, old Mrs. McGuinness is gliding past. Her hand trembles on her walking stick. Her son was killed in a bomb on the Falls Road. He couldn't have been much older than TJ is now. Hello, this is Mary. Leave a message, please. It's her formal voice, all clipped and flat. He opens his mouth to leave a message and then suddenly feels self-conscious and hangs up the phone. He takes the stairs two at a time, four of his long, lolloping strides, and he's in the kitchen. The silhouettes of his ma's plants are casting their shadows over the black and white tiled floor. He stands in the middle of it now, looking for signs of her. The calendar hangs by the fridge, with her scrawled handwriting all over it. Belfast Tech, clearing day, on Tuesday. Aunt Bridget's birthday, flanked by two shakily drawn stars on Wednesday. Today is left blank. He pictures her busying herself around the space, humming along to the radio, inspecting her plants in that intense way she does, holding the pot right up to her face and turning it around slowly in the light, as if there are dark secrets hidden amongst the leaves. He opens the fridge. Maybe she's gone to get groceries. He sees bacon and eggs, tomatoes and yogurts. He takes out the milk and fetches a box of cereal from the cupboard above. He gets a spoon and a bowl and flicks the switch on the electric kettle. The teapot sits clean and untouched by the radio. Has she not even had breakfast? He lowers himself down to sit on the bench and allows his face to drop into his hands. A queasy feeling creeps into his stomach. Could she be upset with him? Because of last night? The kettle clicks in a cloud of steam and he sits up suddenly. He'll go and find her at the park. Chapter 2. Mary, 1990. West Belfast had been softening under relentless sunshine for two solid weeks. The last days of August seemed to melt into each other, punctuated by the occasional sound of gunfire from the barracks and the tinny ring of the ice cream van. Mary lay on her stomach in the small patch of long grass at the back of the house. She was 9 years old, with a small wash of freckles across her nose and hair the colour of fox fur. The garden was no bigger than a bus shelter and was bordered with stinging nettles, but she loved the feeling of being in the middle of it. Like she was part of somewhere else. She was crafting a daisy chain, using her nails to gently push holes through the stems and threading the flowers into a delicate line. She could hear Brian Adams' cracked voice drifting through the late afternoon haze from a window in the distance. There was the hammer of footsteps as a group of boys ran up the alleyway towards the main street. She flinched and ducked instinctively. The alleyway ran along the back of her street, and in the holidays it was a busy byway to the green. Now there came three soldiers, talking loudly, breathing heavily, taking off their helmets to shake away the sweat. The source of the boys' haste. She kept her head down, fixed the two end daisies on the line into each other, and carefully pulled the circle over her head. With the soldiers out of sight, she pulled herself up and walked inside. They were the second last house on the street. The kitchen was tucked into the back corner. It was brown and beige checkered linoleum floor tiles and walls grubby with the residue of years of grease and smoke. The bedrooms were upstairs and Sean's room was the biggest. It looked out over the front of the house. They used to share, but now Mary slept in the box room above the kitchen. It was normal for her to go a whole day without seeing Sean in the school holidays. She knew he was out there somewhere, in a pair of cut tracksuit bottoms and his t-shirt hanging off him, begging a soldier for a hold of his gun, shouting from a wall or a tree, presiding over a football match or a fight. He was always in the middle of a huddle of heads. He stayed out, eating at friends' houses or not eating at all, coming home covered in dirt and sometimes blood to stuff pieces of bread and butter into his mouth before running out again. There were no half measures with Sean. Her father's room was at the back of the house, looking out over the alley. They didn't go into his room. He was there now, sleeping off the night shift. He worked in the sorting office of the Belfast Postal Service. Mary understood the grave responsibility her father carried with his job, to be in charge of all those letters and packages going to the right places. One slip of his hand and a life could be changed forever. He'd be up and out to the Glen pub soon. Over the course of the summer, she had noticed that her father's drunkenness had overtaken his sobriety once and for all. She wasn't sure if he was drinking more or if maybe the drink had just become part of him now, seeping through his veins into his brain, turning everything inside him the colour of cloudy stout. She knew when he had gone too far from the second he walked into the house. From the heaviness of a door slam or his footsteps stumbling on the stairs, she knew to move around him and behind him, to take shelter from him as if from a biting wind. She walked up the hall and pulled the front door open and sat on the front step, wrapping her arms around her shins and resting her chin on her knees while she waited. Mrs. Kavanagh was always first. Her front door opened and her head popped out, looking from side to side. She hesitated a few seconds and then she shuffled to the gate in her slippers and leaned against the post. Then she lifted her face and bellowed her children's names into the air. Connor! Cain! Niamh! Bronagh! Dinner time! Now! Mary watched her as she took a box of cigarettes out of her pocket and lit one and drew on it deeply, closing her eyes in the pleasure of it. She watched Mrs. Kavanagh's face soften as she saw her kids run towards her one by one. She was fascinated by these daily declarations, these names in the air, bouncing around the estate night after night, fascinated by the mothers themselves. She thought of the photo of her mother by Sean's bed. Her back was turned and her head looked over her shoulder at the camera, eyebrows raised, mouth set in a slight smile, like she had been caught in the act of thinking about something that pleased her. Mary practiced that expression often in front of the bathroom mirror. Three doors down, another mother was yelling at her children now too, and another from the street next to theirs. Here was Connor running towards his mother, talking to himself. Jesus Christ, Connor, look at the dirt of you. Then Cain. Wear your shoes. In Jaunty's garden, mammy. Mrs. Kavanagh flicked her fingers towards the end of the road, still squeezing the cigarette. We'll go back and get them, right now. Mary had observed the children of the estate becoming louder as the summer holidays drew to a close. She saw them out the window, running, screeching and shoeless, skipping behind the soldiers until they lost their sense of humour and ordered them away home. Then the tiny twins, Niamh and Bronagh. She watched Mrs. Kavanagh herd her children up the path before stubbing her cigarette out on the wall and standing on it with her slipper. Before turning to go back into her house, Mrs. Kavanagh saw Mary and lifted a hand in the air in greeting. Mary smiled and waved. You all right, Mary McConnell? Aye, Mrs. Kavanagh. She stood up, shy then, and went to the kitchen to put her sandals on, wondering how it would feel to have someone shout her name into the air with such conviction. The home phone clanged through from the hall and made her jump. She ran to pick it up. Hello? Mary, it's Bridget. I need to speak to your father. Right, he's in bed. You'll have to wake him up, so. Okay. Daddy! she called up the stairs.
Aunt Bridget's on the phone.
She clutched the phone, unsure whether to make conversation with Bridget while they waited. A phone call from her was rare these days. Bridget was their father's sister and she had looked after them from when Mary was 2 until she was 5 years old. She took up a lot of space in all Mary's early childhood memories. She was a big woman with a small beak-like mouth that rarely smiled. It was always very clear to them that Bridget was not a replacement mother, mainly due to her relentless insistence on this point.
I'm not your mother. You will not get away with that behaviour with me.
Bridget liked order. She cooked and cleaned and taught them how to do the same. She used to come to the house about once a fortnight to show Mary how to cook the meals her father and brother would want to eat. Here was her father now, making a slow descent down the stairs. He could look like a desert islander after a sleep. The whites of his eyes a surprise in the mess of hair on his head and face. He would have been taller, but his neck folded into his shoulders, giving him a vulture-like stoop. He stood on the bottom step and stretched his arms up. She watched in silence as his mouth gaped open, suspended in a long yawn, and his t-shirt rode up to expose a rounded and rock-hard beer belly. When he flopped his arms back down, he took the phone from Mary. Bridget! She watched his brow furrow as Bridget talked, and she watched him pull the phone cable under the living room door and push it closed behind him. She pressed her cheek up to the wood of the door and strained to hear. He was stood on top of the car. Was it still burning? Where was it? Jesus, he shouldn't be that far away. There was a long pause then. Right, Bridget. Well, thanks for letting me know. Yes, I will, of course. Mary raced back to the kitchen, then opened a tin of beans from the cupboard and tipped them into a saucepan. There was no movement from the living room. She pulled on a cardigan and closed the front door behind her, then set off down the road. She didn't dare look back into the living room window for fear of catching a glimpse of his expression. Across the road, she spied the Barry brothers marching towards their house. She shouted across at them.
Is Sean on the green?
They nodded in unison at her. The green was a small patch of grass and trees stretching about half an acre at the top of their road. You could jump over the wall from the main road and walk straight through it to get to their street. It was empty of bodies this evening, apart from 2 older boys leaning against a wall on the other side, sharing something to smoke. She made her way towards the line of trees at the far end.
Sean!
She stood at the bottom of the tallest tree, staring up into the leaves, searching for the shape of him until she saw movement in the branches and bare legs clambering down. He landed deftly on the bare earth, flicked his hair out of his eyes, and returned her smile with a half smile. He was 11 years old now and stretching out of his clothes. He would be going to secondary school in 2 weeks, leaving her behind to finish her last 2 years at St. John's Primary. They walked home side by side. The curbs were painted in coloured sections, green, white, and orange. Up ahead, some men sat in a row along the curb, clutching cans of beer. Their naked backs were lobster pink and shining with sweat. Mary spoke first. Bridget called. She told Daddy something about you in a car. What the fuck? Sean turned to her. His face was grubby up close. Shite. She must have seen me. At the house, Mary opened the door using the key around her neck and immediately caught the thin, musky scent of her father's spray deodorant. He's way out, she said, and Sean's shoulders relaxed. They ate their beans on toast on the sofa in front of the television as the helicopter started up outside. As she took his plate, Mary asked, Don't you need to get a new uniform for school? He sighed out and rolled his eyes. Sean hadn't talked about going to secondary school at all to Mary. She felt nervous for him. From when she was 4 years old, she had walked to school with her brother. She remembered her first morning because Bridget plaited her hair into 2 thick, neat plaits and tied white ribbons around the bottom of them. And she remembered Sean then taking her hand to walk her through the estate and up the long hill to school. There was a wall up by the main road that Sean sometimes climbed over. He used to give Mary a leg up first, and she would sit on top waiting while he pulled himself over, before helping her down the other side. When it rained, they squeezed onto the bus. The school was one building, split down the middle, each side a mirror image of the other, one for the boys and one for the girls. As he got taller, Sean sped up as they got closer to the school gates, walking just a few steps ahead of her so he wouldn't have to acknowledge her daily goodbye. She still whispered it to herself as she walked behind him.
See you, Sean. Have a lovely day.
She was comforted that his new school was in the same direction from the estate as her primary school. They could still travel together every morning. Sean shifted his weight on the sofa.
Yeah, I have to get a whole new one and books and everything. You better tell Daddy.
His face darkened and he spoke to the TV screen. He's going to be raging with me after today. She looked at him with a serious expression.
Do it in the morning, Sean. You can't help needing a new uniform. He can't say anything to that.
Mary slept deeply when the helicopters were up. Their thick drone drowned out any dreams. But she woke with a start around midnight to the sound of the door slamming. She could hear the uneven footsteps of her father making his way down the hall. She prayed Sean had gone to his bedroom, but there was his voice directly below her, still high and unbroken, speaking short clusters of words she couldn't fathom. Her father's growl rose up through the ceiling and she covered her mouth with her hand. There was a loud crash and the sound of glass breaking and then the back door slamming as her father went out for a cigarette. She sat up in her bed, holding on to the edges of her mattress as if it was moving and she needed the balance. She heard Sean's slow ascent of the stairs. She heard his bedroom door close. She waited until everything was completely still, and then she tiptoed out to the hall and across the landing. The streetlights outside the window were the only light in the room. He lay on his bed with his hand over his eye. She saw tracks of tears on his face. He stayed looking up, not acknowledging her presence until she reached out to move his hand away from his eye. He flinched at her touch, but immediately softened and let his arm go limp. She held his hand firmly, squeezed it, and slowly moved it down to lie on the mattress. Then she saw his eye. It was swollen shut, already crimson from the blow.
Oh, Sean.
She rushed to the bathroom and ran freezing cold water over her face cloth, then came back. Sean moaned in pain as she folded the cloth and laid it over his eye. She whispered, her voice wavering,
I'll go and get you some paracetamol.
Before she opened his door, she pulled her shoulders back and tightened the belt of her dressing gown. She clenched her fists tight, digging her nails into her palms as she quietly padded her way down the stairs past the crooked frame photo of Granny Olive on the wall. The living room door was open and she saw her father's feet stretched out in front of the TV, his hand cradling a can of Heineken. She moved swiftly into the kitchen. The glass butter dish was smashed and lying in pieces all over the floor. She quietly tut-tutted as she tiptoed over to the back door and slipped her pale feet into Sean's trainers, which were sitting on the doormat. She clumped around in his oversized shoes, cleaning up the mess with the dustpan and brush, then poured a glass of water and got the paracetamol from the first aid box. She made a mental note to keep her own first aid box in her room. She turned around and then jumped at the sight of her father in the doorway. He was staring at her with a frightened look in his eyes. She could see his shirt straining under his buttons as he breathed. She saw him look to her hand.
For his eye, she said.
She kicked off Sean's shoes and hurried past her father into the hall. As she turned to go up the stairs, she saw her father steady himself in the doorframe and cover his face with his hands. The following morning, Mary hummed nervously in the kitchen, cooking breakfast for her father and brother. Her voice sing-songed.
"One egg or two, Daddy?"
"Two'll do."
Their father was bent over a newspaper, wearing the polyester trousers and short-sleeved shirt of his Royal Mail uniform. He leaned back to make room for Mary to put his plate down and immediately started stabbing at his food with his fork. Sean was just finishing his fry and quickly stood. He dropped his plate into the sink with such force that the plate cracked in two. Their father looked up.
"Would you fucking slow down?"
He glared at his son.
"Shit,"
muttered Sean now as he lifted the pieces of the plate out of the sink. His eye had flowered overnight into a deep purple colour.
"Here."
Mary handed him a plastic bag to put the pieces in, and he carried it out the door to put it in the bin. When he returned, he sat down at the kitchen table next to their father, fidgeting.
"Da, I started St. Michael's in 2 weeks, and I need a new uniform. Here's the letter."
He unfolded a piece of paper on the table and laid it beside the newspaper. Their father stopped chewing his toast to glance at the letter. His face shone with a thin gleam of sweat. He stared at the amount on the bottom of the page for a long time.
"Are these uniforms gold-plated or something?"
He looked up at his son then and fixed his gaze onto his bruised eye. He closed his eyes for a few seconds before speaking.
"I'll put it out for you on Friday. Remember what Bridget used to say, buy big."
"And son?" Sean looked at him.
"Your eye."
He looked down at his fist then, as if it was a foreign thing on his arm, and for a split second, Mary thought he might cry. Then he focused back on his son.
"Sean, you have to stop this hooligan shite. You'll get community justice. You'll be beaten to a pulp."
Sean swallowed and looked at his feet.
5 days later, on a sunny Saturday afternoon, Sean walked into the back door with flushed cheeks and two plastic bags. He tried it all on for Mary in his room. A dark grey polyester jumper with the folds still in it, a white non-iron shirt, and a clip-on navy tie. Grey flannel trousers with crease set in down the front, and black shoes, one size too big so he could grow into them. He bought a new blue backpack for all his books. Mary opened and closed the zip of the bag, slipping her hand into all the compartments to feel out the space of them. She hovered beside him as he carefully wrote his name on the labels inside the different parts of his uniform. She stood close to him, watching him impatiently flick his hair out of his eyes as he wrote.
"Sean, you'll have to cut your hair. I can do it for you."
"As if. Honestly, Sean, let me try. I can use those thin scissors in the kitchen."
He sat on the stool in front of the mirror in their bathroom with a pillowcase round his neck to catch the hair. It took her half an hour to do it, tongue curled around her lip in deep concentration. And when she was finished, he asked, "Do you think it's okay?" His face was all there, every inch of it, crooked front teeth, freckles on his nose with dead skin peeling off the tip. The skin around his eye was a faded yellowy green colour.
"It looks proper, like a proper haircut," she said.
He looked at himself in the mirror and touched the bruising around his eye softly, testing it for pain.
"Is it sore?"
"Not anymore, no." He sighed.
"That is fucking miserable."
"Maybe he misses mommy,"
Mary said quietly, wiping the hair off his neck with a cloth. Sean touched the palms of his hands to his cheeks and rested his face in his hands.
"She always said my hands were warm as toast," he said.
"You know, when she held my hand." Mary stared at her brother.
"Let me feel them."
She wrapped her hand around his and the corners of her mouth turned upwards ever so slightly.
"They are warm, Sean."
Sean stayed on the stool while she cleaned up around him.
Chapter 3. Mary, 1994.
They walked up the hill together on a brutally cold October morning. The sky was a thicket of dark cloud. They passed the care home and the house with tricolour flags hanging limp out of every window. Sean wore his layers of grey, tie hanging loose around his neck. Mary wore her royal blue blazer and tartan skirt. Her hair was brushed back from her face and hanging over her shoulders. She pushed her hands under her arms to keep them warm. They said nothing until he stopped her at the corner of the tailor's house. "Mary, you go on. I'm going to call on Paddy and go with him, okay?" She squinted at him in sullen silence. It had never occurred to her that she would not walk to school with her brother. She already went home on her own, squeezing onto the bus to avoid the walk past the Suffolk estate. On a bad day, if you walked with your uniform on, you could get stones thrown at you, and the soldiers never helped. She had seen Sean from the bus the day before with Paddy McGrath from the estate and two other boys she didn't know. He was walking different, pushing himself higher on the soles of his feet, flailing his arms around. She watched as he shouted something in Paddy's ear and pushed him hard in the back. She saw Paddy jerk forwards and just managed to stay on his feet. Paddy laughed loudly, but didn't push back. Sean was walking backwards away from her, his eyebrows raised in expectation. "You'll be grand, Mary. See you later, okay?" A magpie squawked nearby. She spoke quietly. "Okay, Sean." She hurried up the main road, frantically humming a breathy repetition of a Take That song that she had heard on the radio that morning. Her blue canvas backpack bounced gently off her lower back with every stride. She tried to focus on the rhythm of it as she sped up her pace, humming herself all the way to the gates of St. Tiernan's School and drifting into the current of blue blazers. The building was set back from the road, three stories of red brick and glass, with several extensions and prefab stretching out behind and to the sides, trying to accommodate the 800 girls who went there from all over West Belfast. Mary was in her second year, and there were things about it that really suited her. She felt safe being part of a system of rules that didn't bend. She liked the purpose of homework and the definitive nature of deadlines, but the formal distance between the teachers and the pupils at St. Tiernan's unsettled her. In her first year, she had stayed out of the way of her schoolmates, quietly observing the ease of their chatter and the natural flow of their movements from the edges of the playground. This year, Louise O'Mara had joined her class and everything had changed. Mary flinched as she felt a pair of hands cover her eyes from behind. "Guess who?" She turned around to see Louise's face grinning inanely about 6 inches from her own. Her skin was the colour of milk, her hair a wispy white blonde. Her slight overbite gave her face a sweet goofiness that Mary loved. Mary burst into self-conscious giggles. "Jeez Louise, you give me a fright." Louise took Mary's hand and marched her towards their classroom, merrily swinging their clasped hands back and forth. Mary rolled her eyes and smiled. Louise was so at ease in her own skin. It was like she had lived in her own body for 100 lifetimes. It had taken a while for Mary to get her head around Louise's public displays of affection. There was something about the idea of hand-holding, of the sense of her belonging to someone that she was breathlessly attracted to. But she couldn't get used to the act of it.
"Well, what's the story?"
Louise looked down at her, still grinning. "Sean ditched me on the way to school. That'll be it now." Louise turned to her, a look of concern sweeping over her face. She squeezed Mary's hand in hers. "Did you get any hassle?"
"No, it was grand. I'll probably get the bus now, though, just to be safe."
"At least it's warmer. Tell Sean he has to give you the money for it. Your hair's gorgeous down like that." Louise was looking at her with genuine admiration. Mary immediately felt the colour rise in her cheeks and swallowed down the urge to tell her to shut up. There was heat and rage in her when she had to think about what she looked like. Lately, she had been whiling away the lonely hours at home after school, standing naked from the waist up in front of the big bathroom mirror. She'd studied herself carefully. Green eyes, dull orange hair, two tiny lumps that you couldn't even call breasts yet. She felt that everything about her was embarrassingly plain. She wanted to fold herself up and slide into the smallest space in every room. As they walked into class, Mary gently pulled her hand out of Louise's grip. Louise paraded through the rows of desks to the front left of the class and Mary followed.
Hey, lanky Louise!
Neva Mahoney, a big-shouldered girl with a face full of acne, shouted at her from the back of the class. A wave of nervous laughter washed over the classroom. Louise gave Neve the finger as she swung her bag off her shoulder and slammed it down onto her desk. Monday morning was double geography. Louise sat in the front row and Mary sat directly behind her. She liked being able to see her all the time. As Louise took out her books, she leaned back and whispered in Mary's ear,
"Hey, are you wearing your you-know-what?"
Mary smiled and nodded. Last Friday after school, Louise and her mother Rita had taken Mary with them on a trip to buy a bra. They had gone to the Marks and Spencers on Donegal Place and stood side by side, listening solemnly as Rita explained how bras worked. The number and letter codes of the sizing was a whole new language to learn, and Mary felt overwhelming relief when Rita's mum bought them both a set of three t-shirt bras that didn't have any fasteners. As Rita drove them out of the city centre that evening, she sat in the back, fingering her new purchases, feeling nervous excitement. She looked at Rita in her driving mirror to say thank you before getting out of the car at the bus stop. It was hard to convey how she felt in words. Rita smiled at her and told her to hurry up and get out or they'd be in trouble. Rita and Louise lived on Arndale Street. It was one of the many streets that fell away from the west side of the Falls Road, sloping down the looming shadow of Black Mountain. Louise's house sat at the very end of the road. After school, Mary and Louise walked the 15 minutes down the length of Arndale, chattering and laughing the whole way. Mary had a bunch of flowers carefully packed into a shoebox inside her bag, picked from the park the day before and put in water on her windowsill overnight to keep fresh. They were her way of saying thank you to Rita for buying her the bra. The girls skipped up the drive and knocked on the door, giggling as Rita opened it.
"Ach, here they are, the clever twins."
Rita had a way of smiling without moving her mouth.
"Get those shoes off and hang your coats up and yous can do your homework on the table down here."
"Rita, I brought these for you."
Mary stuck her arm out with the flowers, a little limp and now hovering under Rita's face.
"Ach, Mary."
Rita took the flowers and bent down, giving Mary a hug with her spare arm. Mary held her breath. She was loosening up to the affection now and she looked forward to the sensations of it.
"We'll put them right here on the table."
Mary took her coat off and hung it on the hook, then walked back into the kitchen to start her homework. Rita was pouring milk into a pan. A baby boy was sitting in the corner of the kitchen in his nappy, all fleshy folds and curly brown ringlets, warbling a continuous stream of noises and syllables. Rita was a childminder by day.
"Ach, look at him all serious, like he's having a proper conversation," Mary exclaimed.
Rita said, "Connor makes perfect sense to himself. It's just a shame I haven't a holy clue what he's talking about." Mary smiled. Louise pulled her tie over her head and shuffled in beside Mary on the bench. She took a long drink of water from her glass and let out a performative belch for her friend and mother.
"Beautiful, Louise. Just beautiful."
Rita shook her head.
"What's homework today then?"
Mary opened her geography textbook.
"Tectonic plates."
Louise sat back against the wall of the kitchen.
"Mummy, our geography teacher, Mr. O'Connell, actually snorts when he talks, and now that we've noticed it, it's so hard not to laugh."
Rita looked perplexed.
"He's like a human pig."
Louise stood up from the bench and threw her shoulders back and stretched her head towards the ceiling. She clasped her hands behind her back and strode around the linoleum.
Now, class, if you open your textbooks to page 56, you will see that the world is actually round and not flat.
Mary and Rita laugh. How does he not notice? Rita asked.
It's like he honestly doesn't know, Mummy. Louise sat back down. Like, how could you live with that every day? Like, sit at the dinner table with him and not say anything? Like, his poor fucking family.
Language, Louise. Jesus Christ, I'd better watch out for that snort at the parent-teacher's meeting, Rita deadpanned, cup of tea hovering in front of her mouth as she leaned against the counter. Mary giggled. 3 hours later, after oven pizza and ice cream, Mary went to the coat rack again. Connor had been collected and Rita was upstairs with Louise's little brother, Frank. Louise hugged Mary goodbye tightly.
Bye-bye, darling. Will you be all right getting home?
Of course.
If anyone comes near you, just hi-ya!
Louise clenched her teeth and karate kicked the front door. Mary laughed as she stepped out into the dark. A few weeks earlier, she and Louise had been stopped by a soldier who asked them all sorts of creepy questions about their underwear and what they wore to bed at night. Louise managed to excuse them by saying they had to be home for their tea. Mary remembered walking away from the soldier, shaking all over, bracing her back for the bullet, and the two of them in perfect unison, breaking into a sprint as soon as they got round the corner out of his sight. When she reached the bustle of the Falls Road, she saw a black taxi and stuck her hand out. It was always either a bus or a black hack home from Louise's, whatever came first. Both were the same price, but the black hacks meant closer proximity to strangers, breathing onto each other and asking questions. The taxi came to a stop and she climbed into the back, nodding shyly at the other passengers as she squeezed into the middle seat. A woman opposite her was holding a young girl on her lap. She stared at Mary with enormous eyes. Mary smiled briefly at the girl and her mother and focused her eyes on the floor to replay the scenes from Louise's house in her head. She considered Arndale Road her own private case study for how family life should be. Louise's father had left them when they were young and had moved away. Then Rita had met someone else and had Frank. Frank's dad worked in Africa, so was rarely around. Unlike her own single-parent family, Arndale Street was always filled with colour and noise. There was singing and screeching and chasing each other around the house. There were legs intertwined on the sofa and arms slung casually around shoulders. Louise moaned about her mummy a lot, but she didn't seem to live in constant yearning for her other parent like Mary did. Mary thought of Louise and Rita's arguments, of which she had seen a few. How they could rage wildly at each other, screaming insults and slamming doors, and be laughing again the next day. All these melodramatic theatrics, like trapeze artists at the circus with their safety net underneath. Rita was Louise's confidant. Her constant. Rita was home. When she got out of the taxi just before the roundabout, she made herself forget Arndale Street and focus on where she was going. She thought about the contents of the food cupboards as she turned off the main road and into the estate. They had barley and carrots and an onion, she knew. She would make soup for tomorrow, she decided, as she quickened her pace, trying not to allow the darkness to frighten her. The air on the estate smelt of burning peat. She saw glimpses of faces lit up by TV screens through Venetian blinds and the odd front door hanging open with people smoking on front doorsteps. Number 42 was always identifiable by its lack of light. In the front yard, the weeds grew tall and wiry up through the cracks in the paving stones. They blossomed yellow flowers, so Mary didn't pull them out. She knew very little about her own mother, but there were some concrete facts that she clung on to, and one of those was that she liked the garden and the flowers that grew in it. Her name was Mary too. She died when Mary was 2 years old. Sean told her that her brain drowned in blood. When she was small, Mary spent a lot of her time wondering when her mother would come back, like Aunt Bridget told her Jesus did from the dead. She opened the door tentatively and paused a second on the step to listen for telltale noises. She felt the wave of disappointment swell through her at the cold silence of the house. She knew there were places Sean went after school with his friends, patches of land he could occupy comfortably without being told to move away. The corners of the park, behind the church, and most recently an alleyway down by their local shop. She knew her daddy would be at work or at the pub. She threw her bag on the kitchen table and ran upstairs to her room, pulling herself up by the banisters. Humming loudly, she changed into some tracksuit bottoms and a knitted baggy jumper. On her way back to the kitchen, she went to Sean's room and pressed play on a stereo. Then she went to the living room and turned the telly up loud. And lastly, she turned on the radio in the kitchen. She put on her old apron and began to peel the carrots. Chapter 4. TJ, present. His mother's voice is loud in his head as the door slams behind him.
TJ, you don't know your own strength.
He walks at a quick pace up the road and out of the estate towards the bus stop. His hands are wedged deep into the pockets of his jacket and his hood is up. He's not in the mood for small talk. As he turns the corner onto the main road, he can see the bus nearing the stop and he runs across the road, breaks into a jog and sticks his hand in the air in an awkward wave. The driver stops and TJ nods in gratitude as he swings himself into his seat at the back. He is breathing heavily. He has to get back into football again, he thinks, as he leans his head against the window. At the sound of a muted beep, he pulls his phone out of his pocket. It's Aidan. What are you saying, big man? His fingers hesitate over his phone. Aidan works as a barman at Devaney's pub in town and had taken on TJ as his fun apprentice when TJ got a part-time job there at the start of the year. At 22 years old and with his own flat, Aidan was a new type of friend. He made TJ's school friends look boring. They were all starting university, getting drunk on cider at Freshers' Week. Aidan was a professional. He got wrecked like other people ate dinner, with a much more sophisticated list of ingredients. He had been responsible for the majority of TJ's hangovers this summer, including the one that sparked the argument with his ma. I have a job for you, Aidan had said as they pulled their coats on their way out the door of Devaney's on Thursday night. Aye? TJ raised his eyebrows sceptically. New skunk. I need someone to smoke it with. Ha! Don't be springing that on me now. Listen, big man, we've had 4 pints each. This can be our dessert. What's your favourite dessert? Aidan cocked his head at TJ, his cheekbones jutted out sharply under his eyes. I think banoffee pie. See yous, shouted Aidan to no one in particular and pulled the door closed behind them. He stopped and turned to TJ. This is going to taste like banoffee pie from the fucking gods. They walked up Ormo Avenue to Aidan's rented flat. He lived on the ground floor of a terraced house on Cairo Street in the heart of the Holy Lands, a cluster of shabby streets tucked in between Queen's University, Botanic Gardens and the River Lagan. The flat stank of unemptied ashtrays and the kitchen wall held a picture of Donald Trump that doubled up as a darts board. They ended up slouched into each other on Aidan's couch in a fog of skunk smoke with Aidan merrily leading them into a YouTube wormhole. Aidan had a little goatee, which he was particularly proud of, and when the skunk hit TJ's brain and Aidan stopped making sense to him, he had to focus really hard on Aidan's moustache moving up and down, watching it dance on his top lip with the rapid movement of his talking. At some point, TJ tipped into sleep and woke up with Aidan shouting his name and laughing maniacally in his face. TJ sat in the back of a taxi that Aidan had called, trying to contain the overwhelming sense of spinning in his head until he realised they weren't moving anymore and the driver was politely waiting for him to get out of the car. He fell into bed in a haze and woke up at 2 p.m. When his ma came home from work later that evening, TJ was lying horizontally across the sofa in his tracksuit bottoms with a carton of milk in one hand and a tube of Pringles in the other, watching a quiz show. She walked into the room, looked at him, then turned around and walked straight out without missing a beat. After rolling his eyes and tipping the end of the tube of Pringles into his mouth, he followed her into the kitchen. When she turned to face him, he blocked her path. He was 6 inches taller than her last time they measured it. Ma, I think you forgot to say hello. TJ, have you seen the state of the house? Have you noticed that you're drinking milk from the carton? Have you smelt yourself? His ma was staring up at him with her handbag still over her shoulder and her keys in her hand. Her nose was screwed up as if she was moving through a rotten stench. Her skin had a doll-like shine to it and was free of makeup. She wore zipped-up overalls to work, like you'd see a mechanic wear, and a big woolly hat that TJ had christened the Mushroom. No, I have not smelt myself, Ma. Have you checked your hair for leaves recently? The hat was off, but her hair was still flattened. She rolled her eyes as he reached over to pull out a small piece of brown leaf from behind her right ear. She stood in the middle of the kitchen, slowly unwinding her scarf from her neck, and walked out to the hall to hang up her coat and bag. When she walked back in, she went to the radio and flicked it on, then turned on the oven. He was at the dishwasher unloading the plates and cutlery. He stepped back to make space for her to get the chopping board from behind the kettle. He saw her take out 2 white onions from the food cupboard and pulled the knife from the dishwasher, holding it aloft for her. For a while, there was just the sound of the clinking of dishes and the blunt thud of her knife on the board, until his mother spoke. It's been 3 months, TJ. We're in September. At some point, you have to take responsibility for this year. Her head was down over the board. He had stopped unloading and was standing with a plate in his hand, his eyes pulled wide in exasperation. I'm aware, Ma. I am so aware. I just need a bit of time to figure it all out. TJ, you don't have the luxury of figuring things out. You apply for jobs. You get in there to anyone who will take you for a proper job. Jesus Christ, Ma. Half yelling, he turned around to face her. She was ready for him, standing with a knife in one hand and half an onion in the other. Don't bring him into it, son. You're collecting glasses in a pub. You have more to give to the world than this. Ma, I'm 18. I can do what I want. She didn't raise her voice to meet his. TJ, I want to see you be the best you can be. Says the woman who works in a fucking park. There was a second of silence. She stood, staring at him, and then quickly swiveled round to the chopping board again. Ma. Ma. She didn't turn around. Ma, I... Oh, sorry, Ma. But maybe I want to go somewhere. This is the time...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.